Welcome to our Bible study for June 4. I'm in the chapel of our church, dressed a little differently than I normally do. We are just begun this week our Day Players summer camp, and we have upwards of 170 kids on our campus any given day during the week. And I am leading chapel in the chapel for the kids. I've done four chapels today, and so it just felt like, well, this is kind of my home away from home, so I'll do the Bible study in here as well. This is not only the beginning of our summer camp, but it's the beginning of a new quarter for us in the encounter material. And for this entire quarter, we'll be studying the Cumberland Presbyterian Confession of Faith. Now, I know some of you that watch these videos aren't Cumberland Presbyterians. It still probably will be worth it for you to watch and to listen and to learn from our confession of faith. A confession of faith simply is an attempt by a church or a group of people to distill Scripture into its essence. This is what we hear it saying to us. This is how we think it is saying to us. This is the story of Scripture. And so you will benefit not merely from learning how the Cumberlands interpret Scripture, but also perhaps it'll enhance your own understanding of Scripture as well. A confession is not Scripture. It is not intended to be Scripture. It's almost like maybe, kind of, sort of, the Reader's Digest version, but with some interpretation as well of what we think Scripture is trying to say. And so I want to briefly give you the history of the Cumberland Presbyterian Confession. We were founded in 1810, as you may know, and at that time, the Cumberland Presbytery, which later became the Cumberland Presbyterian Church, adopted the Westminster Confession as their confession of faith. Now, the Westminster Confession was created, written in English, in 1647, and so this is 1810, so it's been around a long time. Now, they did specifically reject the idea of fatalism, and in 1810 they said that it would be their confession except, and here is a direct quote, except the idea of fatality that seems to be taught under the mysterious doctrine of predestination. And so although we are Presbyterian, we completely reject predestination, and that particularly in its most extreme form says that when you are born you're either elect or you are damned, and there's nothing you can do about it. And that's why they call it fatalism, because it's just fate. There's nothing you can do to change your fate. You either are elect or you're not, and there's nothing you can do about it. And Cumberland's rejected that completely. And so they said, well, we're going to use the Westminster Confession, but we're going to reject that. Well, by 1814, they had realized that there were other things in the Westminster Confession that just weren't working for the Cumberlands. And so they did a really radical thing. In 1814, they made a major revision of the Westminster Confession to try to help it to more conform to the theology that the Cumberlands were developing. Now imagine how radical that is, and I love the fact that we're willing to do that, that we could say the Westminster Confession, although it's been around since 1647, it is not the be-all and end-all, and we think that Scripture says things differently, and so we're going to change it. And so we revised it in 1814. And we kept it that way for a long time until about 1883 it was decided, you know what, we just need to write our own confession of faith. And Reverend J.M. Howard, one of the authors of that confession, said something very important about all confessions of faith, but about ours in particular. He said, "Let it be understood in short that ours is not a fixed and changeless, but a progressive creed. And that through the decades we are to seek a more and more nearly exact statement of the truth revealed in Scripture and believed by our own people." And so God is unchanging, Scripture in a sense is unchanging, but our interpretation of God, our experience of God, and our interpretation of Scripture is not unchanging. And so this is not to be a fixed and changeless, but it's progressive. And by progressive, it just means we will continue as we make progress in our theology, in our understanding, we will need to make changes to that confession. And 100 years later, it was decided the time was to make some pretty wholesale confession or changes. 1883 was the first real Cumberland Presbyterian Confession. 1984, 101 years later, we adopted the current version that we now have. And their idea then was not merely to revise the 1883 confession, but to reformulate it. The theology remained largely the same, but that it was reformulated so that it would reflect on the biblical story in the same ways that the Bible does. And that's kind of the format that they put it in. As Hubert Morrow, who was one of the authors of the 1984 confession, said, he said, perhaps most significantly, the 1984 confession dropped all references to the covenant of law or works on the grounds that there is no solid evidence biblically for such a covenant. Rather, it affirms that the first and only covenant which God has had with the human family is the covenant of grace. And this is a Cumberland Presbyterian distinctive, although it is not one that is exclusive to us. And the idea really is that there's one covenant throughout all of Scripture. Morrow's book is called A Thread of Grace, and that thread is throughout all of Scripture. And there is an old covenant or an old that is the covenant of law, and then the new one that is the covenant of grace. But it's always a covenant of grace. It just isn't fully expressed and fully made manifest until Christ. And one of the ways that we can understand both the covenant and the covenant of grace is to be aware of or remember the story of Abraham, who was Abram at the time when God made the initial covenant with him. And we find that in Genesis, I believe it's 15. And what happens is God makes promises to Abraham. I'm going to make of you a great nation. I'm always going to be with you. But unlike most covenants, God doesn't ask Abram to make any promises back. When we sign a covenant today, if you're buying a house, you promise to pay money and the bank promises to give you money and the homeowner promises to transfer the deed to you. And so it's a covenant between those three parties and all three have to keep their end of the deal. God only makes promises and doesn't ask Abram to make any promises at all. All Abram has to do is believe and trust. And right there in Genesis, it says, Abram believed God, believed those promises, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. And that comes back in Hebrews, and we hear all about all of those that was reckoned to them as what righteousness because they believed. The idea that the covenant is really a one-way covenant, that God is making a covenant with us. Now, remember in that story, there's a rather grisly part of it. God tells Abram to take a heifer, a goat, a ram, a turtle dove, and a pigeon, and he cuts them all in two. And then God passes between the carcasses of all of these animals that have now been cut in two. In the ancient days when a covenant was made, rather than signing a piece of paper and having a notary notarize it and recording it at the courthouse or whatever, they would cut an animal or more than one animal in two, and the weaker party would have to walk between those animals, or sometimes both parties would, but usually it was the weaker party. And what that person was saying was, if I don't fulfill my end of the covenant, let what happened to these animals happen to me. And so today, if you don't pay for your car, they may repossess your car. But back then, you might be sawn in two. You might be executed if you didn't keep your end of the covenant. And yet what happens with Abram? God, not the weaker party, the stronger party, the only one who's made any promises, walks between passes between the animal carcass. And of course, in the story of Jesus, we see that Jesus indeed, not because God failed to fulfill the covenant, but because we did, Jesus allows himself to be killed for our failure to keep the covenant. And so that is grace. And there is a thread of grace that runs throughout all of Scripture. And the idea for our confession is that we can find that thread of grace as well. Now, of course, there are consequences for sin, and Israel suffers those consequences, and we suffer those consequences. But it's not really that we've broken the covenant and we are being punished by God because we broke broke the covenant. But rather, we are just suffering the natural consequences of sin. If I do something to betray you, I'm going to destroy our relationship, and I'm going to have to accept and experience the consequences of that torn up relationship. And so that is our confession, how we got there, kind of. Three quick things to note also about our confession, and then we'll dive into the actual lesson for today is First, if you are reading our confession, you'll see that it's numbered, kind of like the Bible numbers its verses, and starts with 1.01, and then you go 1.02, 1.03, and each little section is numbered. And then one is about the opening things about God in general and about the Scriptures, and then two is God the Father, and it continues throughout the entire confession. One thing that's really important to just kind of keep in the back of your mind as we're going through this, the confession uses the phrase covenant community to describe the church. And it's not that church wasn't a good enough term, but it really is trying to tell us something, that we are a part of this covenant that God has made with us, and we are a community. And God has made a covenant with us. In a sense, we make a covenant with each other to be a community, and we're a community with God and a community with one another. And that word community is such a beautiful word. And so covenant community is indeed what the church is. And then finally, partly I suspect in order to honor the fact that the very first woman ever ordained in the Presbyterian Church was Louisa Woosley all the way back in the 1890s, our 1984 confession uses inclusive language for people. And in other words, what it means is that it will use often the word persons instead of the word men, when the word men would mean everybody. Instead, they use persons. And I love that that's part of our confession. 1984 was pretty early for that. And I'm thankful that we were there ahead of the game again in 1984. Our lesson begins with 1.01. Our confession begins with who is God, and so let me share with you part of that. We believe in the only true and living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who is holy love, eternal, unchangeable in being, wisdom, power, holiness, justice, goodness, and truth, unchanging in all those things. Now, last year at this camp, at our Day Players camp, one of the stories that we did in chapel was the story of Elijah and the prophets of Baal. And you may remember Elijah has this dramatic showdown on Mount Carmel, and both Elijah and the prophets of Baal pray to their gods and say, bring down fire on our sacrifices. And that was the way to find out which God was the real God. The prophets of Baal couldn't bring down any fire because Baal was not real. God rained down fire, completely consuming Elijah's sacrifice, showing that God was the one true God. Well, that is how our confession starts. There is one true and living God. And if we go after any other God, just like the prophets of Baal, we are following a false God that cannot make good on the promises that its prophets may claim that it has. Now, most of us probably are not tempted to bow down to Baal, but all of us, I would hazard to guess, are tempted to bow down to another false God that we find in the Bible. Jesus talks about serving either God or mammon, and mammon is the false god of money or the false god of possessions. And mammon promises us, if you will make me the most precious possession of your hearts, if you will always go after money, always go after me and pledge allegiance to me, I will make you, I will bring you peace, and I will bring you contentment, and I will bring you happiness. But if my whole drive in life is to go after mammon, then I will find that my life is no more peaceful or happy and content than the prophets of Baal's altar was filled with fire. It just won't happen, because mammon cannot provide that. Only the one true and living God can. And so our covenant right up at the very beginning, our confession right at the beginning, reminds us of this wonderful, wonderful truth. Once someone very wise, I think, once said that money is kind of like manure. If it piles up, it just stinks. But if you spread it around, you can do a lot of good with it. And that is a great counter, I think, to mammon, and a reminder that our worship is to God and God alone. Our trust should be in God and God alone. And God alone will make good on the promises that God made to Abram and that God makes to us. Well, let's move on. 1.03, by word and action, God invites persons into a covenant relationship. So God invites us, just as God invited Abram. God promises to be faithful to the covenant and to make all who believe his people. God promises to be faithful. God doesn't ask us. Now, we do have to promise to be faithful, but we don't have to agree to do anything. God is going to do everything for us in this covenant. All who respond with trust and commitment, just as Abram did, all who respond with trust and commitment to God's invitation find the promise sure and rejoice in being members of God's people, the covenant community. And so there we have that phrase, the covenant community. So God invites, God promises, and our job, as Abram's was, is to trust and commit ourselves to God, and then we find ourselves in the covenant community. Well, 1.04 and 1.07 are not about God as much as they are about the Holy Scriptures, and I want us to look at just one of those. I want us to look at 1.05, I want to look at two of them. I want us to begin with 1.05, and that is, the Scriptures are the infallible rule of faith and practice, the authoritative guide for Christian living. Now, some of us may have a Baptist background. I do. I spent a lot of my early college years and my early career really having that word infallible sticking in my craw, because some people who had taken over the Southern Baptist Convention used words like infallible and inerrant as weapons to say, if you don't interpret the Bible the way we interpret the Bible, you don't believe it's inerrant, you don't believe it's infallible, and somehow your faith isn't as good or as important or as right as ours is. And in fact, they were saying that the Scripture is completely flat, that every single verse is just as important as any other verse, and we have to follow and obey all of it, when in fact, neither they, like none of us, did. Every time they went to a barbecue and had pork, they were not living as if the Bible is infallible. And what they really were doing was using that word infallible as a way to try to control other people using their interpretation. And they're still doing it to this day, sadly. But what the Cumberlands say is a nuanced version of this, and it's really important that we catch it. The Scriptures are the infallible rule of faith and practice. So the Scriptures are the perfect rule for me of my faith and of practice. Do I want to know what faith is, what faith looks like? I need to look to the Scriptures. Do I want to know how I practice my faith? I only need to look to the Scriptures. I don't need anything else. Now, I am going to have to interpret those Scriptures. Do I go to that barbecue or not, for example? And that is where we do have some help, and we have help in our very confession. And we need to recognize that we're going to always need help in interpreting Scriptures, and every time we read the Scriptures, we need help. Now, 1.07 says that without the Holy Spirit helping us, we have no hope, and we're not going to get to that today. But that's kind of the overarching of the way that the Scriptures are infallible is the Holy Spirit helps us. But 1.06 is just an astounding sentence, and I want to share this with you. It says, God's word spoken in and through the Scriptures should be understood in the light of the birth, life, death, and resurrection of Jesus of Nazareth. Now, that may not sound earth-shattering to you, but it really is. And in a sense, I am Cumberland Presbyterian because of that sentence. If we interpret Scripture through the lens of Jesus Christ, we have so much a better chance of at least getting it partly right, and we'll never get it completely right, but at least getting it partly right, than if we just say, well, all Scripture is infallible, and I'll just take one verse here and one verse there and make it say whatever I want. No, I have to interpret it and run it through that lens of Jesus and see. Hebrews 1:1 is really a different way of saying this, and it's, long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets, but in these last days, he has spoken to us by a son. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being. So in the past, God spoke to us in many and various ways, particularly through the prophets. And that was God speaking to us, but it wasn't perfect. It wasn't the perfect representation of God's being, the exact imprint of who God is. But through the Son, we do have the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of his being. And so, when we're struggling, particularly in the Old Testament, but even in the New Testament, what do I make of this? How do I know how to act, how to apply this particular Scripture? We need to look at Jesus and see what Jesus says. And so the Old Testament tells us, of course, that someone who was guilty of adultery should be stoned to death. In the New Testament, going through the lens of Jesus, we have this wonderful story in John where a woman is caught in adultery. And people say, hey, Moses says we ought to stone her. What do you say? And they want to hear Jesus say, well, Moses was wrong, or you can't do that, or maybe, yes, let's stone her. But instead, Jesus simply says, if you're without sin, why don't you cast the first stone? Everybody melts away. He looks at the woman and he says, who is here to condemn you? And she says, no one, sir. And he says something amazing. He said, then neither do I condemn you. He could. He was without sin. He could have stoned her. Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. Is Jesus taking sin lightly? Absolutely not. He's saying to her, your adultery is what got you into this trouble. And he knew even more that there's no true love in that. You've been looking for love in all the wrong places, as the country song goes. But now I'm showing you what real love looks like. And I'm setting you free to go and live your life that way. I'm not condemning you because I want you to experience true love. I want you to experience the love of God. I want you to experience what true love among humans is like. And I'm setting you free for that. That's what we are called to do as well. That's how we are called to treat people that are sinners and people who are trapped in sin. In a way, he really summed this up best in the Sermon on the Mount when he says that his mission is not to come to abolish the law, but to fulfill it. And that's also where we see that covenant of grace winding through Scripture. So before we do anything, scriptural or not, we must evaluate it in light of Jesus Christ. And so we have to ask ourselves, and this is one of those tough questions. In the Old Testament, the people understood God to say to them, go into this town and kill every man, woman, child, and animal. But we have to ask ourselves, would Jesus ever tell us to do that? And if God, who is unchanging, and Jesus, who is God, would not tell us to go and kill every man, woman, child, and animal in a town, and I do not believe Jesus would, then we have to recognize that in that day and age, they just got that wrong. Does that mean we throw that out of Scripture? Absolutely not. What God was telling them was, I want you to be unique and different. I want you to be set apart from other people so that you can be a witness. And they got the set apart part right, but they got the way they were supposed to do it wrong. But now that we have the exact imprint of who God's being is, we don't have to get it wrong, hopefully. And we will, of course, from time to time. But if we're looking through the lens of Jesus, we have a better chance than they did, as is evidenced from Hebrews. And so I just love that particular piece of our confession, that we look at everything, understand all of Scripture through the life of Jesus Christ. One way the church has done this throughout the centuries is, my guess is, there are very, very few Christians worldwide, regardless of denomination, who would say that slavery is a good thing, that God ordains or supports slavery. And yet it took us a long time to get there. A lot of blood was shed before we got there. But finally the church was able to get to the place where we understand that God does not condone slavery. If God doesn't condone slavery now, God never condoned slavery back then. And so we understand Scripture through the lens of Jesus. We understand our culture through the lens of Jesus. But we also recognize that even though God doesn't change, we do. And our understanding of God may change. Hopefully in my life, and it is true, I have grown. Hopefully in your life, you have grown in your understanding of who God is. Hopefully that's through Jesus. Hopefully as a church, we are continuing to grow. And rather than saying our confession has to be static, we will remember what the good Reverend Howard said, that from throughout the decades, we're going to make changes because God is continually revealing to us, hopefully, and we're continuing to understand better. And by making changes, sometimes we'll make mistakes, but we trust that God will be gracious with us because there is that covenant of grace running throughout Scripture. So that's the end of our first lesson. We will continue throughout this quarter to study the Scriptures and study our confession as we seek to grow in our relationship with Christ, becoming the covenant community together. Amen.